Greetings, this is another video review by the flashlight reviewer Selfbuilt. Before I get started, just my usual reminder, please make sure you have annotations turned on your YouTube player. I frequently update these videos with additional commentary after I post them, which you won't see if you don't have the text dialog boxes turned on and available. Thanks. Now, as you can see here in front of me, I have a wide range of items. These all belong to the same light or the same light series. This is from a new manufacturer known as Tactical Impulse. And as you see as I go through the lights are clearly designed for the law enforcement community. This is the LE-1, I'm guessing for Law Enforcement 1. And it has a lot of characteristics that I think will appeal to that crowd, and I'll walk you through those in a moment. The first point, as you can kind of see looking at the light, although actually it's a bit bigger than you might expect, this in its basic form is a 1x18650 light. And I'll go through how all that works in a moment. The overall size is a bit longer than a typical light, but it's designed, as you can kind of see here, to replace a classic mag light or stinger. You have a fairly large head. You have a body with some knurling and some checkered areas for grip, but overall grip is pretty good. You've got dual switches. You have a traditional sort of flashlight switch here in the head, and again a traditional tail cap type switch here at the base. There's a lanyard attachment point in the base. The light can tail stand, slightly wobbly, and can headstand. I'll show you both again there. That's not too unstable. Both these switches are electronic switches, and I'll go through the interface in a moment. The head is interesting. If you take a look here, you'll see it has a heavily textured orange peel style reflector with a cool white XML emitter at the base. This is actually more texturing than I've sort of commonly seen in recent years. They're clearly going for a very smooth beam. There's a stainless steel crenellated bezel. So you can see if the light is on upside down, and I guess has some impact resistance, you know, there as well. There's a few other interesting design items. You can see there are two shiny bands here in the head. This allows you to charge the light from the charging dock, which is an optional accessory. And I'll go through that in a moment. I'm happy to report there's no open voltage at these, so you won't accidentally short the light. You actually have to put it into the charging dock to get it to charge. But it's nice that you can have sort of an in-light battery charger feature, and I'll go through all that in detail in a moment. First, let's just show you what comes with the light basically. If I open it up here at the tail, I could use a little bit more, I think, lube on the threads, but I've been playing with it a lot, so it's part of the reason why they're a bit dry. Hard to see there, but there are, you know, fairly fine screw threads. They seem of decent quality, and I haven't had any issues with the light. You can see there's a contact board here in the tail cap with a three series of concentric rings, and that aligns with these three series of connector points at the base of the battery carrier. If I take this out, you'll see that it comes with a carrier for the 18650. Again, the base has, you know, there are basically three contact areas on the base. The head has, in this kind of grid arrangement, it's a two contact points in the head. I'll open this up and you can see the inside of the head where it connects to. You can see there are two contact points there in the head. As you can also see, the screw threads are not anodized at the head as they are at the base. There's double O-rings here in the head, which gives you, I think, extra, is designed for a little extra water proofness. Let me just get that back together. And again, they use, I think, a little more threading, a little more lube there on the threads. So here's how the carrier looks, and it's a bit different than most. It's well designed in the sense that you have to kind of push the battery out. You can see there are dual springs. There's one here at the base, and there's one here at the head of the light, so flat top cells will work fine. There's an indicator, I'm going to put it this way, on the inside of the battery holder, showing you which way the battery goes, and it fits the battery fairly well. My one comment here, though, is it's a little bit peculiar that you can see there's copper wires running on either side of the carrier, presumably carrying current from head to back, and the dual springs are a bit problematic when inserting a cell. Here you'll see their Tactical Impulse battery, which is a 3100 milliamp battery. I'm going to guess it's built around the Panasonic NCR18650A core with kind of a large flat top button. The way it works is you slide the base of the battery against the spring, push down, and it inserts. But you can push out by putting your finger here on the back and just kind of popping it out. But you'll notice because there's a spring here on the head, you have to be careful you don't bend that spring back. So it requires a little care when inserting the battery. For a tactical light, I'd be a little worried how well this carrier holds up to long-term abuse. But fortunately, because of the charging option, you could charge the battery inside the light, so you don't have to keep changing the battery. So I think it's probably fine for the long term. The extra contacts are necessary for the way the light works, and I'll go through all that in a moment here. So in basic form, you have two switches, and they work exactly the same way. So let me just get some of the packaging out of the way. So the light comes with, I should mention right here, with a very clear manual. It walks through all the features of the light, tells you everything you need to know. I find very clear, easy to use, and very thorough. I should probably also show you the box before I put that away. The box details, of course, as you'd expect, the features of the light, an overview of the light. It also gives you all the specifications. So you can see here, I haven't finished doing all my testing of the light, but my initial impression is that these are fairly conservative. I'd probably peg this light as maybe closer to, you know, high 600 lumens, not the high 500 lumen range on max. But all in all, they seem to have done a lot of care here in getting some, you know, pretty good and pretty conservative specs. The battery also comes in its own little container here, so it sort of shows you what the packaging looks like for the individual 18650. Now, so how does the light work? So activation is by either switch, and they work completely the same way. So you just press and release for continuous on, press and hold for momentary. Now they're electronic switches, so they have a fairly traditional electronic switch feel. Not a lot of pressure is required. Same thing here in the head. You can just click to lock on or just press and hold. So your choice. You can see here the light's coming on fairly bright. By default, it's configured to come on in max output, so 100%. I'm just going to show you the beam. If I pull back, you can see it has a fairly broad hotspot, fairly diffuse. You can see it has, you know, sort of a traditional kind of corona as well. I find the extra texturing really helps even out the hotspot, so there's no real, you know, clear demarcation. It's a very continuous kind of gradient. You can't really see that in the office because the lighting here doesn't really allow you to get a good feel for the range, but it's a very smooth transition. One thing in terms of beam tint, I would say the periphery is kind of cool, sort of a purplish blue color. So definitely more on the cool end of cool white, although it's a bit warmer in the center and a bit greener. So you see, tend to see this on a lot of XML lights, nothing really unusual there. So in terms of the interface, if we turn it back on, continuously on, you cycle modes by soft pressing the switch when on. So it came on in turbo, as you saw. Do it again, it knocks it down to medium, again down to low, and once more gives you strobe, and then back to high. Now depending on the default configuration, no matter where you leave it, when you turn the light off, it comes back on at turbo mode. You can reprogram it to have mode memory, and I'll show you how to do that in a moment. In order to reprogram it, you actually need to use the belt holster or the charging dock, and you'll see why when I go through all that in a moment. Something else you'll see here as well, the camera is picking this up, I'm not sure how well you can see it, there is visible pulse width modulation on the low and medium mode. So go back to high, there's no pulse width modulation, but at medium and at low, it's there. You can kind of see it as a camera flicker. I can see it myself in real life. I have to say I'm somewhat disappointed by this. It's a very visible flicker. My oscilloscope readings you'll see in the full review, but I think it's basically around 125 or so hertz, which is a very low frequency for a modern light. I haven't seen one that low in several years now. It's not too bad in the sense that what people don't often realize about pulse width modulation, you know, not everyone is very susceptible to it. Many people don't even see it. If they do, it doesn't bother them. I'm personally someone who's very susceptible to pulse width modulation, so it's often an issue for me, and I pointed out in my reviews. But what people don't tend to realize is that the annoyance, if you like, of pulse width modulation depends on intensity level. And the way that works, if you think of what pulse width modulation means, there's a pulse width that occurs at a regular frequency. And if it just ran continuously, it'd be constant output. But for pulse width modulated lights, instead of running at 100%, they're running a fraction of that period of time. So it's on that long, and it's off that long. Depending on the pulse duty cycle, so how long it's on, is how bright the lights we're going to see. So if you have it on 90% of the time, it looks fairly bright. If you have it on 10% of the time, it looks fairly dim for pulse width modulation. What I find is as you go down to those really, really low on times, so it's only on for a small percentage of the time, it's very visible. As you go up to the higher pulse duration, so say 80-90%, you don't really see it at all. In the case of the LE-1, the medium mode is about 50% output. And here I don't really find it too distracting or noticeable, although I can see it. It's the low mode where I see it more. This is about 20% max output. Here I'm finding it more noticeable and not very pleasing for me. That being said, though, I'll take it back up to max. I really consider this light to be more of a turbo, high, medium, because there's no real low. Frankly, the lowest level here is still, you know, well over 100 lumens. It's still quite bright. The light is really, in a sense, lacking a low mode. And because of that, I don't find the pulse width modulation too bad, because it's really on the real low modes where it's the most distracting. But it is present, and it's the one thing I'd recommend that they work on to try to increase to a higher level. Now, all that said, if you don't particularly care about it, it's not going to be an issue for you. And because it doesn't go down to such low levels, I think even those who are really sensitive to it won't necessarily find the light too bad. But I would appreciate a much higher pulse width frequency. So, getting that out of the way, that's the way the basic light functions. Now, you can see there's a number of add-ons you can get for the light. The first is a battery pack expansion that takes you up to double 2x 18650 size. So, just to show you how that works. So, again, you get another one of their batteries, the same battery you saw before. The way you do this is you simply take the tail cap off. You now screw on the attachment, which has a very similar kind of attachment rings as the tail cap did, as you could expect. You screw that back on. With the extender in place, you have a flat tail cap. You can no longer use the other tail cap. This is just a very basic tail cap. And now this is just a double spring arrangement. As you can see, you mount the cell in the same way as you would normally, the positive towards the head. Screw it together. You now have a double light. Of course, they're in two separate compartments, one without a carrier, one with a carrier. And the light works as before. Turn it on, you get turbo, cycle down modes. There's no difference to intensity or anything like that. What does differ is the runtime, of course. You'll also find the regulation is better at high power. The two cells can handle it better than a lower cell. So you'll see detailed numbers for all that in my full review. So that's one option. And it's kind of a nice one if you want to do that, have the extra runtime. Here's an unusual feature, again, designed for the, law enforcement crowd, a traffic baton. So just to sort of open this up, you can see what this one looks like. Oops. Comes with a little carrying pouch. Let me see that, a little carrying pouch for it. And the actual unit, which screws on here to the base. Now, what's interesting is for this to work, you need to have the battery installed in the main unit, in the light. And there's now a secondary switch that controls this traffic baton at the base. Press it once, light comes on red. And I know this is kind of hard to see here in my office, but they are red bars. They look very oversaturated on the camera. In real life, they look very red. They don't look yellow or orange. They look very red in real life. At both ends, you just can't really see that, you know, too well here in the camera. So, gotta take my word for it. Press the switch again, turn it off, turn on again. You get a flashing, signaling type strobe mode. Lower frequency is not too bad. You can still turn the light on at the other end because, of course, both compartments are just drawing from the same battery. So it's an interesting option if you want to put them both on and have them both strobing, for example. Kind of a cute way, instead of using a battery extender, to have this extra functionality. This gets back to the whole design of the light and the whole way that the light works. This attachment draws its power from the one common battery. It's why you have so many extra connectors on the battery. So it's kind of an interesting little feature. Just put this back together. In terms of this actual unit, I notice it also comes apart. And you have what seems to be little white LEDs there that illuminate in the red rods of this thing in the sort of acrylic plexiglass container. So, cute little feature as an optional accessory. Just get some of this out of the way. Now, the holster. The holster is clearly designed, again, for tactical use. You can see, I'll take out the manual I just stuffed back in there. You can see here on the back, it's kind of showing you what it looks like on a duty belt. And the whole idea of this holster is, you see, first off, it's very substantial. It's a hard plastic. It's not a soft shell. And there's a reason for that. One comment I'll point off right at the start It has an adjustable, there's two screws here. You can adjust the height of the belt clip attachment point. So make sure it fits onto your belt, kind of a cute feature. It's very solid. It comes with its own menu, its own manual. Part of the reason for that is it has some unusual features. So if we take the light back, I'll show you how it fits. You just slide it in here at the top, all the way till it clicks down. Now you see there's an opening there at the base, but the button doesn't protrude. It's recessed by about quarter of an inch or so from the opening. The switch is still available at the head. There's an interesting feature about the holster, and it gets back to how these connectors work. If you have the light on, when you insert it into the holster, it turns off. And you cannot turn it on in the holster. So the design here is to prevent accidental activation when it is holstered. So it's kind of a nice safety feature. It gets back to how those connectors work, and I'll show you the charger in a moment. It's also, if you want to reprogram the light to turn memory mode on, you need to use the holster or the charger. And the way you do that is, and that's why this is open at the base, you press and hold both switches simultaneously for about 5 seconds. And the light will flash. And the flashing indicates that it's changing its programming state. So if we take the light out, turn the light on now, cycle down to low, turn the light off, turn it back on, it comes back in low. So it's now been set to have mode memory, whereas before it didn't. If you want to deactivate mode memory, you just put it back in the holster and you reprogram again for 5 seconds and it'll come back on and then have mode memory turned off. So very straightforward way to reprogram the light. Of course, you need to have the holster or the battery charger to do that. So just a point to keep in mind. Now, I think most people, if they're going to go for a light like this, are likely to be quite interested in the charging solution. And you see the one that it comes with has a quick 3-amp charger, both for auto and for car. I say for car and for home. Also, again, it goes through, they even show you the charging times. So on a single battery, 4 hours on the AC charger, 8 hours with the double battery pack, and a little bit longer for the adapter. It's a little bit more complicated, though, than that. Here, if I open, you can see also all the specs are given here on, get that to sort of fit in, here on the back of the box. One thing about packaging, too, you see they've obviously spent a lot of time and effort in building, open it up here, you can see a lot of different little flaps, a lot of effort in building decent packaging. We take that out of the way. Again, there's a manual which will walk you through how everything works and what to expect. If I open this up here, so you have a couple of items. So you have the charging dock, you have the car adapter, and the AC adapter. Oops, trying to get that all in the field of view here for the camera. So again, your standard kind of 12 volt DC car adapter and a North American plug here AC adapter. You can see the specs given there on the adapter. You'll see all this in my full review. The charging dock has a couple of interesting build features to it. The first thing is you can run the charging dock lying down, or you can mount it, and you can see there's holes here on the side, on either side there. You can mount it on a wall. So if you want to charge the light wall-mounted as well as flat-mounted, you can do it either way. I quite like the connector design. Rather than just a simple little cheap plug-in connector, I'll bring this up a little bit closer so you can see it. You push the connector in all the way, and then there's metal screw cover here that locks it. So this is a good idea, especially if you're going to mount it vertically on the wall. You can't pull it out now, so it'll be very, very secure. It works the same as the battery holster, and then if you slide it in, again, if the light was on, slide it in, it turns the light off. So you can see it holds it quite securely. It's not coming out. Again, you can mount it either way or leave it, flat on a desktop, and it'll work quite well for charging. You just pull it out. It also has the options that you can charge a second cell. So if I take out the other battery, if you had a spare cell, you can keep it charged in the charger as well. So to show you how all that looks. In fact, why don't I just plug this in? I have an AC outlet here on my desk, and you can see the light comes on. You see it flashes red a few times. There's two green indicators that can also go red. So if you put a charging cell and the orientation is marked and indicated there, plug it in and you'll see the light goes red to indicate charging. Again, it's a bright red. It's a little oversaturated here on my camera, which will indicate the charging status of the cell. When it goes green, it's fully charged and you can take it out. I haven't had a chance yet to measure the charge characteristics. I'll do that and I'll post it in my full review. So we'll see if it's safe to leave them in once they're fully charged. The light will go green, and it's a similar process here as well. So if you plug it in, you see the red light comes on. The one that you can't see too well, maybe you can see it a little bit, is that this is a more of an orangey color. The reason for that is that this battery is almost fully charged, and so when you first plug it in, it's solid red, and as the battery becomes closer to being fully charged, the green LED starts to come on a little bit, making this sort of a yellowy orange. Eventually that'll go solid green, which will let you know that the light is fully charged. Now, I've done a couple of charge testing cycles. They tell you the two channels are independent, so it'll take about 4 hours to charge a cell in either way, either inside the light or in the second channel. And it'll take about 8 hours if you have them both together in series in the one light. That's not exactly true, however. I found from my test that it does take about 4 hours to charge the 3100 milliamp battery in the spare battery charger. And what happens here is the light stays solid red until it goes green. So there's no partial indication that the battery is almost fully charged, it just goes green. At which point I found my cell was about 4.24 volts, which is at the high end of what I would like to see in a charger. I like to see chargers terminate around 4.2, maybe 4.22 at the tops. 4.24 is still within spec, but your batteries will last longer if you don't overcharge them. And as you get up into the higher 4.2 range, it's not so good for the batteries. So, you know, that 4.24 is the max I'd like to see. On the left, however, when charging the battery in light, I found this channel charges the battery in about 2.5 hours. So it took 4 hours to charge the spare battery. The same battery inside the light takes about 2.5. And as it's charging, you get kind of an indication as the light changes color from red to green to let you see how close you are. So I'm not sure what the difference is between the two channels, but it's definitely faster on the left. That said, it terminated at a lower voltage, about 4.18 or 4.16 in one case. So it definitely doesn't, actually that was a different battery though, but in terms of these batteries, but 4.18, 4.19 is where it terminated. So it's not terminating at quite the same level as the spare battery compartment. They're definitely independent channels. And I'll give, like I said, I'll do some more testing of that and I'll post it on the full review. You can probably even see over the course of this review that this one's getting closer to being done and the color's been changing a little bit because it's almost fully charged as is. Again, you won't be able to activate the light inside the charger. It deactivates it. A nice feature, I have to say it's a well-designed kind of module. I could see it being very popular for people used to the, you know, Streamlight Stingers or the rechargeable models or the rechargeable mag lights. Much the same idea. Clearly designed to appeal to much the same sort of crowd. So, anyway, that gives you an overview of the light. Hopefully you found it useful. For more information about the light, including detailed output, runtimes, and so on, please see my full review at Candle Power Forums, where you'll find me in the reviews forum under the username selfbuilt, or off my personal website, flashlightreviews.ca. Well, thanks for your time. I hope you found that useful.